Salamta, fellow Rastafari, this is Wendell Alonso. Now let us go into our Father. Who is our Father? We know it, our Father. Most of the world do not know their Father, and they claim our Father to be their Father, but they do not know that. They have not even seen the Father. So I mean, it's pretty, this is really interesting. This is Kedus Johannes Wengel, the Gospel of St. John, chapter 6. Where, you know, let us forward on to verse 66. Let us not complicate our lives. People, if you don't go the way, if you don't take the example set by Getza Jesus Christos, you're going the wrong way. And that is Antichrist, that is death. That simple. But, of course, this world system has convinced us that we are not to just, how could it be that easy, you know, how could it be that simple? No, let us stress about it. Let us complicate our lives. Let us confuse ourselves even more. Let us not, you know, take on that peace. Let us not receive peace and you know, eventually get to the point where either we commit suicide or completely go nuts, go insane. But no, Rastafari chooses to just accept what is to be, because we too are beings, and we exist now and always alongside Geta Jesus, in and through Geta Jesus, alongside I and I Father. But let us just, I guess what we want to do is kind of go over this whole discussion. We have a group of people defending death to the death. I mean, because they're already dead, right? But defending death and kind of like not even just defending death, but just not being able to even accept that another individual accepts life, or even makes mention of life. You know, it's very interesting, and we could see this. It's easily seen everywhere, and religious people in particularly. If you come across you know, whether they be Catholics or Christians. Actually, let us use my grandmother as an example. She was arguing whatever, and she's so-called a devout Catholic or whatever that is. But she was kind of upset of the fact that we study scripture. And she made the comment like what is it, what reward are you going to get? What does it matter if you study scripture? I mean, you're just wasting your time. What do you invest so much in scripture for? Like, it don't work for nothing. I mean, that in itself is pretty. It's pretty. We are to feel. I mean, the fleshy part of us feels sorry for that. But then, I guess we made the mistake of making mention that. Listen, I mean, because of scripture, we know we have eternal life because we just know. We could prove it through scripture, and it brought us to the remembrance of days of old, and that's what it is, and it's not a joke, and I do take this words literally. It's to be taken literally, you know. We have seen the Father, we see how this has been made manifest in its literal form, in a word form, right? So even that is kind of like, what do you mean by literal? But first we had to accept those things that were not seen in order to be able to see, in order to be allowed to see, that it be given to us to see. So first it's that leap of faith. We must have faith. Anyways, you know, I say that I have eternal life, that's what I benefit from scripture, and I could speak it with all sincerity and all confidence, because I know that there is nothing else that is true but that. And you know, she starts laughing and you know, I couldn't help feeling really sorry for her. But this is the attitude that most religious peoples take. They claim to believe, but then they don't. They claim that the word of truth is the word of God, the Bible, but they don't read it. And they can't overstand how anyone would benefit by doing so. And there's case and case. You could go from case and case. They're all different, but a majority will laugh at one claiming to have eternal life. But then, what do you believe in? I mean, what do you think? What's going on in your head? I mean, nothing adds up. Nothing of your you don't do what you're told. So therefore, Getayesu is going to be like, man, get away. I never knew you. You can't say that I'm your Lord if you don't even do what I tell you. Get away. I mean, basically, I mean, there's so many ways to break this down, but enough of that. Let us continue on with the whole argument. So Getayesu is saying, I am the bread, I am the manna. Your fathers ate manna and they're dead. They didn't eat from me. And this right off the start, it just kind of brought to light the whole Christian movements and the Protestant Reformation and all of that. They've tasted manna, they've read the word that is from heaven, but they're dead because they don't receive Getayesus Christos. As a matter of fact, I'm pretty sure that many are well aware that they don't want to, because it all has to do with the 1800s. Christ is coming, Christ is coming. Christ came, Lij Teferi. Christ is Ethiopian, and he happens to be black. Okay, the end of the world, the end of the world, the end of the world, that dark day of the Lord, okay, yeah, we are definitely not gonna receive Christ, basically, is what most people are saying. So they did eat manna, but they're dead, and it's the same situation here. And so Getayesus goes on to say, I am the bread of life. If those that take part of me, that eat my flesh and drink my blood, which is the life, I mean, we're not gonna go into the whole scripture, but we just want to point out a few different very, very, very interesting verses. And first one, we'll start from verse 44. It reads, no man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. No one can come to me, this is no one can come to Getayesus Christos except the Father which has sent me, His Imperial Majesty has sent to us Jesus Christos. If except the Father who hath sent me draw him. What is draw? What is draw? Draw is Old Testament. It is an outline. It is a foreshadowing of things to come. It is what is expected of us. It is what is. It is an outline. It is a letter, a void of form. It is what we are supposed to value and give meaning to and content and fill it up with life. We are to act and to behave a certain way. We are to behave in the manner of which we have been taught to do so in the Bible. That is our Father drawing us, like kind of like, okay, this is the outline. Now fill it. Live it. Be it. And now, and then Getayesu shall raise us up in the last day. Whatever number of days we have been allotted to our pilgrimage upon earth, so be it. If we keep in faith, with the strength of faith and with patience in time, we know that we shall be taken up by Getayesu's. And yes, I do personally take it literally. I take it to be what I can only accept it to be, true. The real thing. I'm not gonna half this, half ASS this, Either it's true or it's not, and I am not going to be cold nor warm. I am going to be straight and keep to that narrow way, And I hope that many can find that way and fit. So now let us continue on to verse 45, as a matter of fact, and it is written in the prophets, it is written, read your Bibles, people, and they shall be all taught of God. We shall be taught of God. Every man, therefore, hath that hath heard that hath heard and hath learned of the Father. And who is this Father? Kedamawi Kalishalasi. I mean, it can't get any more clear than this. The prophets have written, they will be taught of God. Every man, therefore, that hath heard, we have heard his imperial majesty, call us by another name. And let us make mention, let us reference that. Your imperial majesty, this is the question, the interviewer, your imperial majesty, there are certain Christianos that, oh, we forgot the next part, but he says something like that, think you're God or something like that. Forgive me, I guess that's kind of, that's a sign that we're being a little too aggressive. I guess, you know, forgive me for that. That is, I take full responsibility for that. But there are millions of Christians throughout the world, your imperial majesty, that regard you as Christ. Oh, we give thanks. And so he responds by saying, we have heard of this idea, and we have spoken to certain Rastafari. We have been called by a new name. I mean, it's that simple. The interviewer said, there are millions of Christians throughout the world, your imperial majesty. And his imperial majesty says, I have met certain Rastafari. Like, we've heard of this idea, so we've heard, and we have met, we have seen the elect Rastafari. And I told them clearly that I am a man. Yes, he is a man. And that he would be replaced. And this is us replacing him in his proper place upon the throne of King David. You know, and heaven is his footstool, heaven is his throne, the earth his footstool. And so on and on and on. So basically, we just wanted to make mention. But continuing, so it's pretty clear. So therefore, we shall be taught of the Father and learned of the Father. Come it to me. Okay, let us read this again. And they shall be all taught of God. Every man thereof that hath heard and hath learned of the Father, come it to me. What does his imperial majesty instruct us to do? To go to Quieta Jesus Christos. All things given by the Father to the Son. Given from the Father to placed in the hands of Quieta Jesus Christos in his power. Wow, I mean, if one's really just can't overstand this, we shouldn't even say that. I mean, we know what the reasons for that. We apologize. We're not trying to get all rough on some of y'all. But, you know, just open your heart to the possibility and we assure you our Father will not disappoint you. Now let us continue. Not that any man hath seen the Father, save he which is of God. He hath seen the Father. So many will say, oh, no one has seen God. That's not the case. It says here, save he that is of God. So if you're of God, you will see the Father. And here's the funny part. Here's the light shining in darkness, and the darkness comprehending it not. A lot of people have seen his imperial majesty, but they cannot see him. So it's funny how you know, if ever, I mean, if they're, you know, once they're kind of like eternally suffering damnation, it'd be kind of sarcastic or kind of it would be kind of funny if one realized that, oh, we did see him. Then how come we're here, you know, if we did see him? Because they did not see him. And we're not going to go into the whole depth of seeing and seeing. There's many types of seeing. And you know, that's all a part of the confusion that is this world system. You can see, but that doesn't mean you can see. Continuing, let us go on forward to verse 49 says, and your fathers did eat manna, in the wilderness and are dead. And so we liken this to the good Americans. America took on the Christian. They stole they took on the Bible, but more correctly, they stole all this knowledge from Ethiopia. And so they ate the manna, but they are dead, you know? And continuing, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. People start laughing at this point. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. And people start saying, oh, see, it's not speaking literally. This is parabolic. This is word picture. This is metaphor. This is simile. It is everything. Our God is holy and eternal. It is one. And so how could it lack something? That which lacks in Rastafari shall be filled, fully filled by another Rastafari. So yes, it is a simile. It is a metaphor. It is word picture, but it is complete and full and holistic, and therefore it is also literal. Now, continuing, he that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. This people that are not familiar with Rastafari is what we refer to as the I and I, that which many can't understand. So continuing, as the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. So this is what most individuals throughout the world that have eaten that bread but are dead, this is what they ask. They eat the manna and then they say, what is this? What is it? Because they don't know. They're dead. Only the living know about the living things. The dead worry about the dead. And there's a verse right here that we, when we read it, we saw like the demons like twisting and warping the shape of the faces of these Jewish leaders, and how they didn't even say this in a high voice. They kind of like they hissed it like a serpent. They said it with complete anger and hatred and envy. And we can't find it, but it says something like, sayest not us well that thou art that thou art like a devil or something like that. Man, we can't find it. Forgive me for that. But it's like Getayesu says something and he completely shuts them up. But they're so filled with hatred and envy. It was very interesting that when we read this, we couldn't help but seeing the faces of demons in these individuals, and like it kind of like in a Hollywood movie when they speak in a very low voice, but kind of creepy in a sense, because they couldn't stand such truth and life. And so I guess let us continue on the forward. Okay, we kind of remembered. It's not even in this chapter. It's chapter 8. Verse 12 of chapter 8 says, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. So this is very interesting, because the way it plays down, it's like they have some light, and this is talking about the Pharisees, Sadducees, the leaders and rulers and judges, whatever they call themselves. This discussion is going to lead from light, from some kind of light, to less light, until they are completely blind, and those that were blind are completely restored whole. And it's funny, because that what we mentioned those faces that we saw, and I mean, as crazy as it may sound, we heard these voices. I mean, the voices were kind of creepier than the faces, but it was really interesting, a really interesting experience. I think that's that point where they reached complete darkness. So let us go into this, and verse 19 kind of gives us the beginnings, I guess. It's then said they to him, "Where is thy father?" Jesus answered, "Ye neither know me nor my father. If ye had known me, you should have known my father also." And we just explained that earlier. But let us continue on to verse 30, chapter 8, yea, Johannes Wangel. As he spake these words, many believed on him. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, "If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free, shall make you free." And this is what they answer, right? "We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?" This is so interesting. Back to the good American. Here in America, their father is Abraham, but they confuse it with this Abraham because they don't read, and they haven't noticed, they haven't figured out that these, white supremacist Gentiles, they're confusing their dead father Abraham with our living father Abraham. And it is very interesting because here Getsaiesu says, if you follow my word, then truly you're my disciples, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And this is the answer. We be Abraham's seed. We've never been in bondage to anyone. We've never been in captivity. We've never been slaves or anything. That's right. They've never been slaves. The white so-called Jews that are not have never been slaves. They have never been captive. The European so-called Christians that claim to have established this Christian country based on foundations of Christianity, they too have never been captives, or at least they may not remember of the Dark Ages where they them never mind, we're not going to get into that, but this is something they would respond to Getsaiesus. We have never been captive to anything. Well, you've been captive to the idea of superiority, and that is a sin. And if you sin, then you are captive of sin. So let us continue to kind of get a better idea as to what's taking place. Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say to you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth ever. And the son therefore shall make you free. Ye shall be free indeed." So they could have been freed if they accepted the Father, and therefore they would have received the Son, but nah. How can His Imperial Majesty free them if they've never been captive? It's like His Imperial Majesty said, "Watch, it's us today, it'll be you tomorrow." And they were like, "Who is gonna do this to us? We are Europeans, we are advanced, we are civilized, we civilize Africa, we civilize the world. Only we know how to live," and really foolish ideas. And surely enough, along comes a man named, well, a beast named Adolf Hitler. And Europeans never even saw it coming, because who in this world could oppose such greatness, such vain imagination, such superiority in the color of a man's skin and the color of his eyes? For we are much superior, we are much evolved, and so on and so forth. So yeah, basically they have become ever since servants to sin, and they got a small taste of what we've been experiencing for the past to directly connect this to prophecy for the past 400 years, but even this initiated probably a little before that. So let us continue, and let us also make mention that KPBS radio station San Diego is a very great radio station. They come up with these really interesting topics, and they talk about these things, but they don't see it because they are completely blind. Like that show, and they were talking about for profit county jails, and you get the, I mean, some sheriffs were on the phone talking about this. Yeah, we trade, like if we need a mechanic, then we trade him for to another county jail that has a gardener that we need, and the more inmates we have, the more money we make and stuff. I mean, these people are saying this like on the air, like if nothing's wrong about it, and they start talking about how much money they make per inmate, and it all has to do with getting by taking the responsibility away from the state and away from the federal government. So they set up these county districts where they take care of inmates, and the state and federal will actually pay them, so that the state and federal don't have to take responsibility for these inmates. And so the reporter, not too bright, but it's like something deep within her was kind of like, shouldn't, I mean, was kind of like forcing her to say something to the effect of, isn't this kind of wrong? But kind of like laughing within herself, like, nah, it can be. These are sheriffs, and they're white, and they have blue eyes, and most of their inmates are colored or African American or black. Nah, they can't be, this can't be wrong. And surely enough, I mean, the answer that the sheriff gives is genius. I mean, and this is relative to their darkness. No, it's helped us. This is, I mean, the sheriff is so funny. He says that no, on the contrary, this has allowed them and enabled them to rebuild their sheriff department, and to buy new ammunition and new weapons and new cars that before they used to have only two, or like one or two patrol vehicles, and now they have a whole army of patrol vehicles and weapons and guns, and that they can defend. Who they can defend, it's quite clear who they are thinking of defending, and it's not us. But yeah, I mean, that wasn't even the point, but basically, back to the whole KPBS, there's another report, and they're speaking about the Civil War, and all this ghostly activity taking place in the White House, and this is during Abraham's, their father's time. You see how it all connects? They're speaking, they were saying that in the times of the Civil War, the President Abraham Lincoln and all the people were doing seances and calling upon spirits and welcoming ghosts and doing all kinds of like unrighteous deeds, because the country could not believe that if that God was doing this to them, being that they were his chosen, that they had established heaven on earth, that because this is, that is what these people think that America was. They could not believe how, because the Civil War, let us remind everyone that the Civil War was pretty bloody and full of death, and it's all accredited to the intelligence and the brightness of these individuals. Americans never noticed that the technology of warfare had far outweighed and far surpassed the old methods of fighting. So you had a bunch of red coats and a bunch of blue coats, even to this very day, or silver coats, I don't know, it's north and south. But anyways, walking and facing each other with these brand new forms of warfare, of weaponry. We're talking about machine guns even, to a certain extent, and these new, more accurate, more explosive, more harmful rifles and stuff like that that could be loaded faster and could have a more clear shot and more precise, more accurate, more deadly, and then cannons, you know? And so they walk up to each other and they start shooting each other. This is the brilliance of the founding fathers of America. I mean, they couldn't even come up, they couldn't even think of that, like that the weapons they were now carrying far surpassed the old methods of warfare. And so basically, I mean, this was bloody. This was probably one of the worst wars that has been seen. Okay, we just have to say this. American citizens, good Americans, took their children and set out picnics alongside the battlefields to watch. This is a fact. People went out. That's why they still do this. They're probably subconsciously they're trying to hide their idiologies, their idiot ologies. And it's funny now that I think about it, but that's why they reenact the whole war, and you have people along the sides because this happened. People went out there and they thought that they, oh, look, it's so exciting. The North is going to fight the South. Let's go check it out. And in a sense, they're still trying to do that by UFC and stuff like that. But yes, I believe it, you know, and check it out for yourself. This is true. They took their families, they set up camp, they took food to kind of make it like a picnic. These are God's elect, right? Supposedly. When fires started being shot, they found out the same thing that the soldiers found out. These weapons are far beyond that which we even noticed. And so yeah, that did not work out for the best. That people since then have not attended wars, you know, as spectators. You know, they settle for UFC. Now, let us continue. Just to, I guess we want to wrap this up because in a sense we're kind of making fun, but it's 'cause I mean it's pretty difficult not to. But it's in hopes of opening the eyes of these individuals that, I mean, it's in your best interest to listen to the wisdom of Rastafari because your own people will not tell you because of their own pride. Now, we may have been fooling around, but we pray that it comes to the point where we can laugh at this together in the sense that we together have overcome. Now we're not setting differences, all right? Like and we're getting serious now because enough games. I mean, this is for the wicked. Laughing at them is for the wicked, and not even right, but I guess what we did was. But we hope that we can laugh together at this and reach a point in time when our children cannot believe the grandfather telling us the story of a time in human history when nations, first of all, the kids won't know what nations are, but then the grandfather says yes, and they fought wars and they would kill each other. We hope to get to a point where the children laugh. White along with brown and black and yellow and red and pink and everything. Where they laugh it off, and they all kind of make fun of that child, saying, "Your grandpa, your grandfather's crazy. Why would anyone want to kill each other? Why would anyone want to design nuclear weapons? Why would anyone want to fire weapons and kill living, breathing, spirit-fueled individuals?" Okay, so let that be well known. All right, you know, we hope to get to that point, and we will, but it's a matter of will you be there? So, you know, take your coat of pride off and put on Christ Jesus. And, you know, and shine in his righteousness, not yours, not mine, not ours, but his righteousness. So lastly, we want to make mention, and this is we're still in chapter 8, Gospel of Saint John. Okay, verse 42, let us wrap this up with this. Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech, even because ye cannot hear my word? Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh his own, for he is a liar, and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God. Then answered the Jews, and said to him, Say we not well that thou art a Samaritan, and hast a devil? This is that verse. They're fighting for death. They're fighting for death. They cannot stand truth and life. They've reached an all-time low. They've reached the truth. They've been confronted with the truth, and they see a reflection of themselves, and they hate it because they cannot love it. Everything they are is hatred and lies and death. And therefore, they speak of themselves when they say, Say we not well that we are good Americans and hast a devil within I? And we're speaking as if we are the Jews, in this case, the good Americans, good Samaritans or Samaritans. I mean, this is spooky. I mean, say we not well that thou art a American and hast a devil? This is speaking of themselves. This is a reflection of America. America loveth death, but they hate life. They loveth lies and they hate truth. And well, because when the devil speaks a lie, when the devil lies, he speaks his own language, English. And also, because Satan, Cain, the devil is a murderer since the beginning. America, we are murderers since the beginning. This country was founded on murder, on rape, on theft, on every sin you could imagine. Wake up. Just wake up, you know. You know, we're just gonna, like, this is pretty sad. So, Shalom, Rastafari.